Our name is Jonathan Meads, and this series is called Abroad Again. It lifts the stones of British buildings to reveal the life forms beneath them. Follow us down a B-road of discovery, down life's lonely highway of adventure. So Abroad Again then, for a social experiment which has touched every one of us. Really.
Heaven. Folk woven in England. In the land that never was, there was so much lead in the lights that the inhabitants of these houses were poisoned and rendered imbecilic. In the land that never was, the wood was wany. No one could saw in a straight line. That'll have been because of the lead poisoning. In the land that never was, thatch was poured, like crimper's treacle. No wonder that 1970s light entertainers came to covet such houses. They enjoyed the security of two hairdos.
Where is this?
West London, since you ask. But it might be anywhere in England. Much of England looks like this. No other European country does.
When did this happen?
1928, but it might have been 1918, or 1938, or, astonishingly, even 1988. Comforting hedges, cosy wicket gates, mellow brick paving, sweetly hanging tiles, here are the means of escape from the most murderous century. We walk forever down False Memory Lane, yearning for a place where the oak was beyond a joke, for a time when the quaintness was 100% proof.
An Englishman's home is his fantasy. We're so inured to architectural escapism that we hardly acknowledge it. And we hardly stop to consider that the bucolic past that such houses represent was brutal, cold, diseased, incestuous, and that our forebears spent much of their life in pain.
We take this stylistic escapism for granted. We're running away from what? From ourselves? Why?
This is Richard Wagner writing in 1855. Here is Alberich's dream of Nibelheim come to life. World domination, frenetic activity, oppression by steam and by fog.
Alberich is the grotesque dwarf of the ring cycle, the autocrat of a subterranean hell of mines and primitive machines where perpetual night reigns in the inhabitants of the living dead.
The place that Wagner was comparing to Nibelheim was London, the largest city on earth, the most industrialized city on earth. Nothing like it had ever previously existed in actuality.
Though something akin to it had evidently existed in the apocalyptic fantasies of such artists as Wagner himself and Bosch, Boots, Bruegel, epic catastrophe wrought by cosmic wrath, Gotterdammerung. The whole world came to gape in appalled wonderment at the sublimity and squalor, the magnificence and destitution. London was a thrilling dystopia. That's how it was represented by Cooper of Olney, by Cobbett, Dickens, Mayhew, Augustus Egg, Charles Kingsley, Hippolyte Taine, George Gissing, James Thompson, Gustave Doré. The London that Dr. Johnson had equated with life itself was a city of 500,000 inhabitants. Little more than a century later, it had swollen to become the Victorian megalopolis of 6.5 million inhabitants, which was all too readily tired of.
The population increased by 500,000 during each decade of the 19th century. Bronson Alcott, father of the author of Little Women, described it as a huge den wherein Beelzebub whelps.
As London had grown, so had the number of voices fretting about the multitude of problems it occasioned. Mortal diseases, vagrancy, crime, drunkenness, starvation, pauperism were commonplace. Rioting was unastonishingly routine. London's administration was chaotically corrupt. In 1855, the rights to excise tolls on roads were still sold at auction. There was no public provision for drainage or waste disposal. The water supply, much of it contaminated, was divided between 8 competing companies. At the root of this chaos was the economic Darwinism of an unregulated market. It was a doctrine, and any challenge to the primacy of commercial interests was a sort of heresy.
As the MP and industrialist Joseph Cowan put it, noise of workshops rolls like music of another epoch to proclaim the dawn of the day when trade asserted its independence and industry claimed its rights.
The megalopolis was, until the second half of the 19th century, regarded as an inevitability, a force of corrupted nature. The great philanthropists, the Earl of Shaftesbury, Thomas Barnardo, Baroness Burdett Coutts, believed that their initiatives would eventually create a city that was livable and just. They worked within the system, affecting reforms through legislation, moralistic paternalism, and the hand of God, which hand was also responsible for a vigorous program of Anglican church building.
Throughout the 1840s and 50s, Anglican churches were consecrated at the rate of more than 2 a week. Institutionalized superstition was deemed to be the remedy for cholera and, equally, for the sweated slavery of child labor. The path to betterment was paved in tiny blood-stained bandages, for the well-meant fixes were no more effective than the application of an elastoplast to a rectal hemorrhage.
In the second half of the 19th century, the emphasis of anti-urbanism shifted away from fulmination and denunciation. Such ragings were merely the sound of the impotent rattling their bars. If London was the city of the future, then the future was to be avoided.